Facebook, and I forgot to start the recording. Yeah. So, Dr. Gaurav, thank you so much for being here. So, please tell a little bit about yourself to the people, because I told my perspective. And so you can tell from where you started as a resident doctor and where you are now. You'll be very motivating for everybody else to hear. Thank you so much for taking time out and being here with us.
Thank you, Thankam. It's always a pleasure participating in any forum with you. For everybody's information, I think the best introduction was that I'm a friend to Thankam, right? Because she has really been a asset to our organization. By training, I am a medical doctor. I am a DMB in medicine. I started my career with Fortis Mohali itself, where I met these two ladies, right? And then moved on from clinical to medical administration to PNL roles. I was handling hospitals. And then I moved out to set up hospitals outside the hospital. And the beauty about hospital outside the hospital is that it is run by nurses. The doctors, they admit their patients into this chronic hospital, but they have to devote their time more on acute patients in the hospital. Hence, the nurses become the backbone of hospital outside the hospital. And today we are the largest one. Yes, very challenging times where I think we got the due recognition during the COVID times. I would definitely say thanks to COVID for that. It was long awaited. But I'll talk more about what all we did during COVID times and how nurses played the most pivotal role in that. That's all, Thankam.
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. Thank you so much. Thank you once again to all my panelists. And without any delay, let me get into the first question. The first question to each panelist will be that what has been your experience around mucormycosis in 2020 and 2021? What is it that you saw? And as we already agreed, the answer should be in 3 minutes' time, not too long, so that, you know, we can cover more questions. Because if we take longer, then obviously we'll not be able to cover. And to all the attendees here, in case you have questions, you can start putting it in the chat box. Otherwise, we already have some questions that has come through email, which we will be addressing during the session. So this time I'm going to use the alphabetical order so that, you know, we are very clear how we are going. So I'll start with Dr. Afreen first. A. So that is Dr. Afreen.
Hi, a very good evening to all. I would like to let everyone know, and everybody is aware of it, the cases have been drastically increasing. It's been 2021, and if you compare to 2020, we hardly had any cases there. Although I have an experience with mucor earlier itself, reason being I work at a setup which is a transplant-based setup. So post-transplantation, it is very common for an individual who have any kind of fungal infection, including mucormycosis, or they may even have aspergillosis or other fungal infection associated with it. So we do have a lot of experience to fungal infection other than the one we are getting in 2021, that is mucormycosis. Now in 2021, that is, you know, in the second wave of COVID, the numbers have drastically gone up. And what I have noted, I'm just going to stick on to the last 2 to 3 weeks, what I have seen, it is around 18 to 20 cases at my own hospital. And I'll say that it just spreads like cancer. It's super fast, you know, from one to the other, it just rapidly spreads. So we have to keep a very close watch and we should follow it up very precisely. Even a delay in 2 hours can lead to more problem in the individual. Like, you know, it spreads from the sinuses to the orbital and then it can even go up to your brain. To be giving equal importance and get it diagnosed at the earliest and proceed with the surgery or start on the treatment. Thank you.
Thank Hello. You, Dr. Afreen.
Am I audible?
You're audible. I just put your video off because your audio was really lagging. Switching off the video sometimes helps your audio becomes much clearer. So maybe that's better. Can I request the audience to please mute your phones? Mute your phone. Who is QCOM BTD there? Otherwise, to all the panelists, in case I mute all the participants, so you should be able to unmute yourself and speak. Because if they are not listening, that's my last resort. I have to mute everyone. So Dr. Anita, what has been your experience from 2020 and 2021 around before?
Yeah, so Tanka, my experience has almost been kind of similar to what Afreen just said. In 2020, we didn't see a single case of MuCOR, right? And we were talking, hearing about it from some pockets in Delhi, from Rajasthan, but at least in Punjab or the tri-city area where we live, we didn't get to see any COVID-associated mucormycosis. Having said that, in 2021, I mean, we were seeing a deluge of patients. You know, it was at some point, it was about up to 3 to 4 patients per day is what we got in our hospital. Of course, there were referred cases, and ours is not a big hospital. We have a very big institute here in Chandigarh, the PGI, and they were seeing a phenomenally large number of cases, up to 4-fold increase from the last time, you know, in 2020. And interestingly, all the cases that we saw in our hospital, they were, of rhinos involving the nose and the sinuses majorly. And we didn't see any case of pulmonary mucormycosis, and one case we did see of cerebral mucormycosis. So, very debilitating diseases, and I'm told that, you know, from my colleagues in PGI that, you know, they were in the pathology department, they were getting eyes by the line of it, you know, so many eyes coming in a day. Remove those eyeballs because of this orbital mucormycosis. So this 2021 has been very, very devastating, of course. And I think, the reason have been multifactorial. COVID added to a lot of pre-existing comorbidities that are already existing. And as Afreen said, that in transplant patients, we do get to see mucormycosis. But my experience has been that prior to this 21, it was only anecdotal. There were not cases that we could see probably in 6 months. But recently, we got to see a lot of them, which was scary.
Thank you, Dr. Anita. Now, let me move on to Bona. Mona, what has been your experience in your hospital?
Ma'am, actually, in last year, the experience what we had only 2 cases found. And in that, one was the post-COVID patient. And the other was didn't have any contributing factors regarding mucormycosis. So, then when we see the 2021 in this year, as the Dr. Anita also told, like from the January or February month, we started getting the cases, and mostly a lot of patients like from ICU itself we were having, and they were seen, basically they were seen those who were having the predisposing factor or the patients who were having diabetes. So we got very early, I think so 3-4 cases where we had cases which patients were diabetes. So in that context, we further went into the detail, and then as the cases were increasing, we got more cautious about the things. So treating the patients simultaneously, we were more focusing on preventing part also, that how can we prevent getting the patients into mucormycosis. So that was the main focus for us. As the patients, some few patients we got in June month, it was a peak, not peak, but we had few cases than April, May month we had 9, and then we are still seeing reducing in the cases. So but the thing is, like we are just checking out that how can we prevent this, and the patients who are there, predisposing or the factors what is aggregating to this case, this sickness, is maximum in the cases what we have found is diabetes. So from our side in our hospital that we have seen, and okay, the patients who are going through steroids. So that is the thing.
Thank you, Bona. Thank you very much. So Dr. Gaurav, you are not from hospitals, so you are outside the hospitals. So you have seen it in 2020, you are seeing it in 2021. So what has been your experience?
My experience has been, I think I would have the least experience in managing mucor in this panel, right? Having said that, I think I've seen a few cases during my PG or my ENT rotations. That was way back, right? 2020, we didn't see a single case. At least I didn't get any case to be managed at home, right? But 21, I think we just surpassed Bangalore in the number of cases we had and the surge we had in Delhi. And corresponding to that surge, I think the surge in Delhi was huge for mucor also, especially in the government setup of LNJP and all. We also heard of many patients in the private sector also. And I got a lot of calls where, as Dr. Anita mentioned, there was this debridement happening, which was very, very disfiguring, right? And most of the patient attendants called ki karana zaruri hai ke nahi. That was another thing which was happening, cross consults and all, because it's quite frightening. Having said that, and one very interesting thing which we heard of, and there were few cases that were of non-COVID patients who were diabetic, but were ignoring diabetes because they were not getting any attention. So all these patients were sitting at home because they didn't want to go to the hospital. They thought that they can their test and routine examinations can be delayed because of the surge and all that stuff. So that led to ignoring and a few cases. Having said all that, I think we were able to treat two cases. One was on post-debridement care of the patient, and one was antifungal infusions at home. So that's it. What we have observed is that there is a lag to which the patients come at home. For example, once the acute condition, the patient gets into the hospital, and then when the beds are getting full or there is a subacute chronic management which is required, which will now come in mucor after the debridement has happened and the antifungal treatment has happened, I think we are getting ourselves ready to manage those patients at home as soon as it happens.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. Dr. Shushin, I think probably he is the person who is the, I would say, the front warrior when it comes to mucor. I have not seen anything like this in my life, though I have spent 16 years in very high-end critical care units, but mostly abroad. I think I only read it. And when I am now trying to read, my God, it is so frightening because it is so disfiguring. It is so frightening. So what would you say, Dr. Shushin, from last year to this year? We'll come to the why later. Let's hear your experience first.
Yes, ma'am. Quite rightly said. So the index case of mucor in India happened in Delhi on 30th of January last year. That was the first case which was reported in Delhi. And then we have been working through the first phase of the pandemic. Now we are in the second phase. In the first phase, what we saw was, even though we were running kind of skeletal OPD and the inpatient services through the entire COVID season, we had the opportunity of treating only four COVID-associated mucormycosis. I work in a tertiary care hospital in Bangalore. I'm Fortis Banagatta Road. We have a 280 bed strength, and it is one of the preferred healthcare destinations in Bangalore. So, in spite of that, we had seen, I think, four cases between April and August last year. 2020, April to August, we had about four cases. All four were operated on. Thankfully, they're surviving till date. We were very aggressive with them, and we take it on a war footing as it needs to be done. So all four patients, yes, albeit with some amount of residual issues post-operatively, we had treated four patients. In contrast to that, you know, this year in the second wave, I saw my first mucor in the outpatient on April 30th, 30th of April, 2021, and today is June 15th. We have operated on 128 patients so far. So it's a massive number. Definitely not a happy surgery, as you said. Disfiguring on many occasions, yes. Only when if the disease is limited to the sinonasal tract, as Anita ma'am mentioned. If they come in early and then there is only sinonasal involvement, we are able to get away with a simple endoscopic procedure. We may not have to resort to, you know, gory interventions such as orbital excentrations, palatal excisions, and, you know, sometimes interventions in the brain. We have treated three patients who had intracranial abscesses in the frontobasal area. We have been able to, you know, evacuate them endoscopically, and they're doing well. So there is definitely a very big spike. You know, and this has been the similar experience with a lot of my ENT colleagues that have been treating mucormycosis in the city. Bangalore is a referral center for the entire Bangalore as a city is a referral center for the entire state. Most of the cases initially had trickled down to Bangalore. So there have been colleagues that have operated more than me. And then I think the overall collective experience in this season alone, I would say in the last 6 weeks, in terms of surgical experience is above 1,000 cases. There are 1,000 procedures done in the span of last, I would say 5 to 6 weeks, which is massive. To give you a comparison, I have been practicing in Bangalore for the past 12 years, 10 years with Fortis. I had seen 8 cases in the last 11 years. So the previous bunch of cases I had seen was in my post-graduation. I worked in a very high volume center in Ahmedabad. I trained in the municipal hospital and we were a very, very high volume unit. Despite that, we had treated only about 10, 12 patients back then. These are as my colleagues mentioned now, patients on chemotherapy, patients on cancer care, uncontrolled diabetics, you know, bordering on diabetic ketoacidosis. Those were the patients that came in low socioeconomic status. They don't know what's happening. They don't know what to do. Those are the patients we had the experience with in our post-graduation days. After that, then fast forward to 2021 now, 128 cases with my own team is mind-boggling.
Thank you so much. I think it's so frightening. So the next round of question, the first question is also for you, Dr. Sushin, is that what in your opinion is the reason for, can we call it endemic of mucormycosis? Is this endemic? Can we call it endemic?
Why do you think
that we are landing into this trouble?
Right. So by definition, we know endemic is something which is kind of localized to a certain geographic region. But unfortunately, in terms of numbers, you can say, yes, mucor is a subset of the COVID. In that sense, it's endemic, but then it is not limited by geographic location. For example, I can talk from my state. I work in Bangalore. We have been getting patients from up north, you know, the deepest pockets in the north, in the west, in the down south, from all pockets. We are a referral center, as I told you. So we have had patients from across the states, across the borders as well. Yes, it has exploded as an endemic into the pandemic, I would say. So do I have a chance to show some slides here? I think I have a couple of slides.
I can just give you that.
I don't miss out on what I want to say. I have a few simple slides.
One sec, sure. I have given you permission, you can share.
So I'm going to share screen, right? Yeah. So COVID-associated mucormycosis, yes, it is definitely seen with the patients that are pretty much in the recuperative phase. Typically, we have seen these patients come in with symptoms between day 14 and day 21 after testing positive or after developing clinical symptoms. Some patients have come in as early as day 8. We have had to operate on active COVID patients, you know, so that they don't lose out on a chance to get better. And we have had patients who have also on the other extreme come in at day 45, day 40. Oh. After clinical recovery. So why is this happening at all? This is the biggest enigma that we are faced with. So most of us know, I would like to tell the nurses as well, that COVID virus by itself has a thrombotic tendency. So it tends to, you know, cause coagulation within the blood vessels in the circulation. It is known to cause strokes. It's a neurotropic virus. It has an affinity for the brain, for the cranial nerves. We have heard of people, you know, patients getting hearing loss, facial nerve paralysis, and visual loss as part of the COVID sometimes. So COVID itself, being a virus with a strong thrombotic tendency, that I would say kind of prepares the bed for the mucor to happen. So inevitably, we have physicians on the panel and they would agree. The COVID sometimes is so severe that we may have to treat COVID with a lot of steroid medications. You know, when you look at the risk benefit ratio, the amount of risk you take while choosing not to use steroids versus giving a steroid and, you know, maybe bringing down or scaling down a pneumonia in a bad patient outweighs the risks of not using, you know, of using steroids in a bad patient with a COVID pneumonia. So steroids are the necessary evil, you might say, in this kind of a clinical scenario. So as an offshoot of that, because of steroids, yes, most of the patients that we have treated have come into the hospital to us with sugars above 400. When they report to us, I've had patients with sugar 400, 500, some with ketones in urine. That's the kind of presentation they come in. Some of them come in drowsy. Definitely, there is a thrombotic tendency in the COVID itself. And there's a diabetes-like state. A lot of patients might not be diabetic because they come in, they are 30, 32 years old. They have no history of diabetes in the family, no history of diabetes themselves. But then when they come in, they would have received steroid for about 8-10 days. And then when you look at their blood sugars, it's way above the normal limit. And I think one of the issues that, you know, we might have to look at is how these people use the masks at home or in their hospital environment. Because a lot of patients that have reported MUCOR have traditionally come from the rural or the suburban beds. I would be proud to say that we have been screening our inpatients in the hospital that have contracted COVID before discharge. And most of them have been able to go out of the hospital without MUCOR. Two or three patients that were suspects also eventually turned out to be, you know, negative for MUCOR. So what happens is that there are a lot of patients that don't have access to proper healthcare. They might end up using dirty masks. You know, a bad mask tends to concentrate a lot of bacteria and other fungi as well. We know that MUCOR is ubiquitous. It's all over the place. It's all over in the environment. So technically anybody can catch a MUCOR. So personal hygiene and how an individual uses masks is of critical importance. And of course, now, you know, there's only a thought that I have in my mind, you know, does the new variant or the continuously mutating virus have an effect on the islet cells? This is just my thought. I'm not sure whether there is a transient effect on the pancreas itself, which is causing the patient to develop a diabetes-like state. We don't know. So I think we need a lot more research. In fact, we are collaborating with four groups already to bring out a consensus, a paper on what really is the cause of this pandemic, of this MUCOR endemic within the pandemic, and what are the lessons to be learned. So we will have the data in about maybe 3 to 4 months from now. We are compiling data with three or four large centers, and we would definitely tell you about that in some time. Another interesting observation is that most of the patients that caught MUCOR were unvaccinated. And to begin with, when this MUCOR started about 2 months back, the vaccination was not available to the age groups of 30 to 45, and it had just started, or it was just being made available. And given the shortage of vaccines in our country, most of the 85% of our patients were unvaccinated, or some of them had received one shot of vaccination. There is a rampant use of antibiotics, and we know antibiotics, overusage of antibiotics can definitely breed fungi, and then they get an upper hand. So that is something we need to really look into. And again, another speculative dimension, people are fanatic about steam inhalation. You know, people feel, you know, when they have a nose block, they have to steam. They steam so many times. I have patients coming in with red noses, you know, the forehead all burnt, eyes red. You know, does this excessive steam inhalation damage the ciliary motility? This is a question that I have in my mind. When the ciliary motility is reduced, when the surface cells lose their vitality, does it give access to the MUCOR particle to enter the system? So these might be tiny gaps that, you know, understanding which we eventually have to bridge so that we can understand the nature of the disease better. One of the big things which goes unaddressed in most of our government systems is they do not use safe water in the oxygen delivery mechanisms. So distilled water or sterile water is the recommended use for any of the oxygen delivery systems. Definitely, we have seen in the government systems here, you know, there has been rampant use of tap water and unhygienic water. We're literally putting the fungus into the upper airway. So we really have to have emphasis on sterilization of our oxygen delivery system and the humidifiers. These are the things I think.
Got muted, Dr. Shashin. Please unmute.
Yeah. Audible now, madam?
Yes,
These, I think, are a gamut of factors which so far that we understand that they collectively come into effect to cause a mucormycosis.
Thank you, Dr. Shusheen. I think you had been very, very basic, and all these thoughts, anyone who thinks a little, it will be of really, really, very valid points that you have shared, though whatever that I had been reading. So there are some questions around this, especially the oxygen, etc. So we'll come back to that in a while. And there are some more questions for you already coming up in the chat box. We will take it up. And now, if you may stop sharing the screen, Dr. Shusheen. Next question is to Dr. Anita. Dr. Anita, can you, is it possible for you to quickly, tell us about the pathophysiology of mucormycosis? So, how does it enter, and then how does it spread? So quickly, a little bit in very basic language, that will be good for all our nurses to learn. Dr. Anita, are you there?
Yes, I'm there. And thank you for your question. Very important. And as Dr. Shusheen just mentioned, that the spores of mucor are everywhere in the environment. And somehow, they love our country. The maximum number of mucormycosis in the world has been reported from India only. So it's not that this is something new which has come up. It has always been there. But the only thing is that, immunocompetent people like you and me do not get this infection. Now, we can very easily handle it. It's only the immunocompromised patients, like patients who are transplanted or who are on steroids, prolonged use of steroids, or who are severely neutropenic and uncontrolled diabetics. So these are the major three or four subset of population which are going to get the disease, right? And it's like a fungus which is everywhere. Now you leave a bread for some time and you get a mold on it, a nice woolly cottony kind of a growth, that is your mucor. So it's so present everywhere, right? So what happens is, how does it get inside the human body? The major roots of infection are inhalation. That is, you inhale it through your nasal passages. You can also ingest it through your oral cavity. Or it is the cuteness. Like, for example, you have an abrasion, a cut, or something in the skin, and the spores get deposited there, and then they may start an infection. That's particularly seen in cases like burns patients, or even in hospital, where you sometimes put, you dress your wounds and all.
Got muted?
Yeah. Typically, mucormycosis has never been a hospital-acquired pathogen in the past, right? So it was majorly a community-acquired infection that we were getting to see in the hospital. But of late, we're also seeing cases happening in the hospital because of poor infection control practices, right? Now, important thing for all of us to understand is that it does not transmit from one person to another, like COVID does. Right? So it's not that a person is having mucormycosis, it will spread to the next person also. So that means it gives us some safety margin within the hospital with respect to its transmission. Now, having said that, once the most common route is through entries into your nasal cavities and also wherever it enters, it is a very necrotizing kind of a fungus. It is filamentous, it has got like long filaments and it has got spores. So once it enters it, in the body, because of our immunosuppressed nature or because of, low neutrophil counts, it's unable to mount a defense mechanism, a defense attack against this particular fungus. Interestingly, this virus loves, it needs iron for its growth, right? It loves iron, it wants iron. So typically what happens in diabetics is that because of the acidotic state, right? There is a availability of free iron. From the iron gets released from its bound state, and that iron is available. And that's why we see a large number of this mucor cases in uncontrolled diabetic patients. So once it enters, it starts its process. It releases some toxin. There's one toxin called mucoricin, which is very, very toxigenic. It produces inflammation, and then it also has a thrombotic capacity. And the spore of this fungus have a special affinity for the cells lining the blood vessels. So what happens is it produces a little a lesion there, a necrosis and thrombosis, and through that it gets into the blood and spreads to very different sites. And that's why it's called as an angioinvasive fungus, and that's why it spreads so very fast to distant organs. So the most common, as Dr. Sushin also mentioned, is the rhino-orbital cerebral kind of a mucormycosis. So when it enters the nose, it will cause the lesions over there. It will, from there, it will, all the, organs in the face, it will enter the sinuses. If not controlled, it will enter our eyes. And from there, it can even go to the brain. So this is a very, very, once it goes to the brain, it becomes very difficult to manage and control it. The easiest form is once it is localized to your nasal passages or even the sinuses, that is the easiest one to handle. But once it spreads out, it gives you very little time. It really kind of, as there is, it's like a medical emergency that you need to look into. So basically the mechanism remains, it's very angioinvasive, it's very necrotizing, it's very fast spreading, and all those situations that I just mentioned, they kind of just help its spread to different sites. So this is how the mucor basically spreads and it causes its manifestations.
And it spreads very quickly, right?
Very quickly, very quickly, within no time, it will. And the symptoms are so vague to begin with. You'll have a nasal blockage or a discharge that patients may ignore or a slight pain. So that's why your patient education is very important. And alongside patient education, the nursing education is also very important because they need to make their patients aware of it so that they can pick up these signs early and report to the doctor at the earliest, right? So not to be treated. So along with COVID specifically, since we've seen a large number of cases occurring to this particular skin peak, patient education is extremely important. And for that, this session is very important so that your nurses also understand the gravity of the situation, that earlier the treated, the better does the patient stand a chance for less disfigurement and a better chance to live a good quality life.
I think that is very, very simply put. And I think for me, I understood the pathophysiology very quickly, much better than reading something that, you have never seen. So you put it very, very easily that, once it gets into the vessels and, then it spreads very quickly. Did you also say that it can spread through cuts? Through cuts?
Yes, of course. Yes, of course. Yeah. So what happens is the skin, any breach skin is the biggest barrier to the entry of the microorganism. That's like a suraksha, kavach that we always carry with us. So any breach in the integrity of the skin allows these pathogens to kind of, find a susceptible host over there. So if those, and especially the bandages, we use this, elastic bandages in the hospital. And I remember, even in our trainings, what we would do is we would cut a lot of these bandages and put it on the trolley so that, we could simply put it on the patient. The trolley would go from one person to another to the patient. So, sometimes these kind of practices, the spores get stuck to those bandages. And when you put the bandages on those, a denuded skin or a breached skin, it gives a good environment for the spores to multiply there and start a cutaneous mucormycosis. And on the same lines, even the gut, it sometimes can cause, problems in a gastrointestinal mucormycosis, the similar mechanism that the patient is vulnerable and there's a denuded gastric mucosa. So any breach either in the skin or the mucosal surfaces will allow the spores to enter. And if you have the setting of any kind of immunocompromised nature, the fungus will multiply. And having said that, I would just like to add one more point here. While we are seeing a lot of cases of mucormycosis in COVID times, we're also seeing other fungus like Aspergillus. A lot has been said about mucormycosis, but Aspergillus is also not to be left behind. And we are seeing a good number of cases of Aspergillus also. Although it's not all that debilitating like mucor is, we can still control it. We can still manage it better than we do with mucor.
Yeah, thank you so much for that very basic anybody could understand. Thank you very much for that. I do have some questions around your answer, but I'll come to that later when we have the question answer rounds for the sake of everybody else. It'll be interesting for all nurses to learn that. So let me now go on to Dr. Gaurav and ask that you already talked about your home care space experience, Mucor. So how do you think that the nurses are contributing in that home care, and how are you preparing your nurses for this increased number of patients who are going to be at home post-surgery and care? How are you bringing them up? Dr. Gaurav?
Yeah, Thankam. So
Thanks. I would also like to take 1 minute to share our, I would say, a very unprecedented experience of managing this whole COVID thing, where I believe that nurses played a very, very strong role, right? The second wave, I think, was so overwhelming for all of us that each and every one of us had to step down. I had stopped practicing until last year. I was not practicing medicine anymore. But the whole sheer thing made me practice also and manage COVID patients. And as rightly Dr. Dutt said, there was no choice but to use steroids as much judiciously as we want, right? So in the whole of this scenario, I think trained nursing professionals played a very, very pivotal role. Right from saying, we had always said we need physician assistants, we need to free the doctor from the rut work, and the nurses have to take that, and the nurses have to do very, very professional job, and nursing assistants have to take that as another cadre. We saw that all that happening live. Just to give you a small recap of what we did, when 2020 things started happening, we got a lot of queries, kya ho raha hai, kaise ho raha hai, why this COVID is happening, what to do. It was not regular times. You could just pop in a Crocin and ignore your fever. And that's where we started with the, I would say, teleconsultation platform. Rather, I would say we started with the helpline where people wanted to speak to doctors, and that led to a teleconsultation platform where then a doctor was prescribing RT-PCR test, and that had to be done at home. We became the largest partners for Fortis across to do this. And then when government took out the 18th May guidelines of management of COVID patients at home, we started with private sector retail patients, right? And very soon in the surge of July to September, Delhi government came up that they wanted to ramp up that program. We worked with the governments of Delhi, Karnataka, and Punjab. And you won't believe, Shankam, we had 500 nurses calling lakhs of patients with a 97% of recovery rate. And that led to such a burden, lightening of burden on the hospitals. Otherwise, all these patients would have landed up in the hospital. In the second wave, the Delhi government again came and said, now we don't even have the strength to manage the triaging of all the people who are becoming RT-PCR positive. So we started taking data from the Delhi government at ICMR site. We had to call at least 25,000 patients a day, and we had 1,500 nurses doing that job. And all these, and we did multiple levels of audits. We didn't get a single escalations because we had responsible nursing professionals managing such an epidemic. When the doctors were doing their own job in the hospitals, this was a fantastic job which HCH did with all nursing professionals. Forget it when we used to say that nursing is not available, nurses are not available. I was surprised by my own team that we could raise 1,500 nurses in 3 days to manage lakhs of patients. So that is something I really, and that's where opportunity came in. And you know why this opportunity came in? We changed the model to a profit sharing model with the nurses. It was no more a salary model for the nurses. Even when in this second deluge, we set up a Lemon Tree Hotel in Sector 29, Gurgaon, as a 250-bedded oxygen facility. And we did not hire nurses on salaries. We hired nurses on consultants, as you do doctors. And we again did a profit sharing. They were ready to go into that facility to have that exposure where I had full-time doctors. Why not to give them their due? And that's why we were able to ramp it up and do it with the best of the quality, because we were able to attract that talent. So this has been quite a learning experience for all of us who are saying that nursing is always in shortage. And so I think we learned that this model could work and save so many lives where nursing professionals were working. That's on one. And this was all done by nurses, right? I single-handedly could not have done it. Doctors could not. We didn't have doctors. To get a doctor into that hotel facility was much more difficult, I would say that, right? At the same time, I feel that the cadre of nursing assistant, physiotherapist, at least in out-of-hospital space, we could not get them to work. It was nurses and doctors who were standing with the patients. Coming to our experience in home care space for mucormycosis, I think the two clear-cut distinctions are, one is prevention and education for immunocompromised patients, which I'll touch in the next question, the role of nursing. And I think the second part is on post-operative care and post-hospitalization care, where what we did was that the largest center catering to MUCR was LNJP. So we got our nurses to train there and to have all the knowledge on how to administer antifungals, what post-operative care to be done, right? So all that we did, we are preparing our nurses through proper protocols. We have developed a new service around all this. I've spoken to doctors, how can they get patients home early so that they don't get any secondary infections in the home. So that's, I think, the preparation phase going on. And this we have done in Delhi, we have done in Bombay, we have done in Bangalore, Kolkata, and Chandigarh. So everywhere, standard protocols on how to manage these patients at home. But I think we are still waiting for those patients to come out of the hospital.
Thank you so much for sharing your innovative practices during COVID and how nurses have risen up. I think that's a food for thought for everyone, that if you innovatively manage nurses, maybe we will get more nurses.
I would like to add, sorry to all these nurses were working on mobile phones and entering all the data in the forms on mobile phones. It was all technology driven, not a single piece of paper and pen. And again, nurses were managing it.
So I think classical example, give them an opportunity, they will rise up to the occasion. Don't doubt them. I think that's what the entire story is about. Thank you so much for sharing all that. It's really heartening. And when Dr. Gaurav told me that he found 1,500 nurses, I asked him, from where did you get 1,500 nurses? Everybody's telling shortage. So now I know how he got. He made them business partners.
Yes.
Correct?
Yes.
I think it is time for looking at those models. It is important. Maybe it may not be so easy in a hospital setup, but still, I think it is time to maybe look at things in a different manner, so that you can attract the nurses. Thank you so much for that additional information. That's very heartening. And I'm sure the nurses sitting here, they're very happy to listen to those developments. And then, of course, technology is now no more becoming a barrier for anyone. Okay, somebody's writing nurses are the backbone. I'm so used to hearing this backbone and heart. So now I don't like backbones or anything. I would say nurses are very important partner in the healthcare delivery system. You know, let's not, even I have used those terminology. Now I think it's so much very easily used, not heart and backbone and this and that and also. But I think we are one of the strongest pillars because it's a teamwork, right? And nurses, by sheer the space they occupy and the number they occupy, they become very, very important in that particular team. Thank you so much for that. Dr. Afreen, next question is for you. Antifungal medications have always been a concern because this is something I have seen when I was in hospital. When a patient is getting antifungal, I have to go and check how they are preparing, what they are doing, you know. So can you briefly tell us the major keep in mind points for nurses around antifungals? I mean, what are the things that they should be taking care of when they are using antifungal? Dr. Afreen, are you there?
Yes, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you're audible.
Thanks for the question, ma'am. First of all, I will let others know that it is really an important drug to get the person into a better state. So the first thing they should remember is give amphotericin B or posaconazole.
Dr. Afreen, one second. Your voice is again lagging. Can I put your video off? Then your audio becomes clearer. You can't hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Dr. Afreen, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, right now I can hear you. If you can put off your video, we can hear you better. Yeah.
Am I audible now, ma'am?
Yeah, it's much better. Thank you.
Okay. Ma'am, all the antifungals, be it amphotericin B or posaconazole, all these is always better to be given in the central line. Because if we put it in the peripheral line, it can lead to phlebitis. Posoconazole for the first dosage can still be given as a peripheral line, but second time, please do not, because its high concentration will definitely cause problem to the weight. The other thing, equal dilution is very important. For amphotericin B, if we are taking 50 ml of the solution, it should be mixed well with 50 ml of 5% dextrose. If by chance it is given in peripheral line, we can double the dosage for dextrose, 5% dextrose. So if 50 ml, we can put it to 100 ml dilution. That will help prevent the complication. This is one thing which is important. The other thing that they need to keep in mind is they need to hydrate the person before giving amphotericin B. So the hydration, pre-hydration and post-hydration, both are equally important. Pre-hydration, one has to go for at least 2 units of normothaline for pre-hydration, and then they can give the drug over 6 hours, followed by they should again go for post-hydration, which is important. Around 1 unit of NS has to be given. This is important when we are going to give amphotericin B. The other thing which is to be kept in mind is if any drug reaction takes place, so one has to be very careful to that. Then other than that, person should always be looking forward. Once the drug has been administered, it can be changed into the tablet form to follow up for the individual. Their levels of posoconazole is also important to be checked. So once in 7 days, this has to be checked and the values needs to be reported. So we have to brief the patient because doctors are not round the corner all the time. So it has to be taken care. Moreover, the compassion is very important because the patients coming are too much in fear. So they have to be more polite and more nice to them to make them understand there's nothing to worry and you're going to get better, because everything together will make a bigger impact to them. So the infusion should always be slow. If we are giving isavuconazole, it has to be a 1 hour infusion. And again, we need to dilute it with 100 ml of NS and it should be given over 1 hour. And these are pretty safe for the kidney, that is isavuconazole. And when we give posoconazole, there are certain contraindications. So any drug reaction has to be seen, as well as it to be avoided if the person is on rifampicin, ketoconazole. So those things are very important. Moreover, these people need to be monitored for a very good diabetic control, because if the sugars are not well under check, definitely to get the infection under control will be very difficult. So regular monitoring of the blood sugar and reporting to the doctor about it, so that things can be brought down together and it shows a better improvement for the individual. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Afreen. Does this medication, do they need any special equipment or anything for preparation, or it's a regular, you know, mixing, matching, like any other medicine, or is there any other special precautions for preparation that is required?
Ma'am, you're not audible to me.
Oh, others can hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, I think she has...
Now I can hear you, ma'am. Please tell me.
Okay, okay. My question was that when we are managing antifungal, amphotericin B and all these sonols, you know, antifungal. So is there any special equipment or anything, you know? And there is a one quick question that has come. Can we dilute amphotericin in normal saline? So can you answer those questions? Is there any special equipment required when you are preparing the amphotericin?
Ma'am, equal concentration is very important. There is nothing specific required, but it has to be measured in equal quantity. That is very important. So far, we haven't diluted amphotericin B with normal saline yet. We have only done it with dextrose, 5%. So that is the best.
Okay, okay. Great. Thank you so much. And I know that when I was in the hospital, this antifungal administration used to be very specifically, you know, observed by seniors and to make sure. I'm not able to remember exactly that, you know, what was when they were, fungisome. There was something that they were using to mix. I'm not very sure what was that. I'm not able to recollect. Way back in 2012. I'm not very sure. That's something
time, they were at that time, Thankam, the amphotericin was not liposomal, and they had to be very, very photosensitive. So what they had to do was they had to wrap the whole tubing with these black paper so that when it's going into the patient, it doesn't get exposed to light at all.
That's
the most cumbersome thing which had to be done at that time, which fortunately now liposomal amphotericin you don't need to do.
Thank you. So that is the answer. Okay. So that's a very interesting question I asked, no? Like a good student. Yeah. Thank you very much for that. That's a good information. So they are no more photosensitive, right? You don't have to do all that stuff. Okay, great. Thank you so much, Dr. Afrin, for that. And now let's move on to the next question, that is to Bona. Bona, tell us the common challenges that you have seen among nurses when it comes to caring for mucormycosis patients. Maybe not too many, but whatever you have seen, what were the challenges that you observed the nurses were having in caring for patients? Please unmute yourself, Mona.
Yes, ma'am. So basically, as we told that we had not seen much of the cases, but whatever we had the cases, in a context to that, we started more of having the prevention part of that. But when we got the cases, first thing nurses initially was that they were not, they were scared of this increasing cases of, and as we were hearing a lot from the newspapers and of everything. So basically what we saw is they were not having the basic knowledge of mucormycosis. So that was making them arise the questions like whether it is contagious, if they are taking such patients for the care. That was the first question that was coming to us, and they were asking, ma'am, can we have any special precautions to be taken for these cases to take care for the patients? Then second was, or any specific, second question was like from the OT side, when the patients were going for debridements and all. So the staffs concerning from the OT, they were having concerns related to how to disinfect the instruments if such cases comes. So we were they were in that lack of knowing the about the mucormycosis, they were having these questions arising that how to disinfect or any special precaution or disinfection to use to disinfect the instruments what we are using for in the OT for such cases. Then third was related to sample collection and transportation. So initially we have faced some challenges regarding how to collect the samples for the patients who are going through like suspected for mucormycosis. So usually in initial they were sending the nasal pharyngeal swabs. So then we had to have a streamlined guideline or the policy written, and we how to send, get the samples and how to transport the samples. So that was another challenge for us. But when we gave them a proper guideline, how to do the process, how to collect and how to transport, they were confident enough. And then next was related to the challenge what we faced was when we were talking about the oxygen therapies. So we were having flow of COVID patients. So when we talk about the oxygen therapy, where it talks about humidifiers, sterile water, and disinfection of the humidifier, or doing its sterilization. So there we had challenges because we had back-to-back patients. Once the patient was getting discharged, we had back another patient waiting for the bed. So it was very difficult for us how to go through this, that we can send the humidifiers and all for the ETOs, for the sterilization purpose. So that was one of the challenges. But yes, through the training sessions and getting the alternative options for doing the thing, getting the humidifiers for the next patient, getting it ready. We got the options and then we ran through that process with the HIC team. So these were the few challenges that we had, but I think so most of them was related with the training and the knowing a knowledge about the mucormycosis for our staffs. So that we did in long term in training our in charges, because since our staffs were doing 12 hours duty and all was happening, so we were not able to connect with them. So first we trained our in charges regarding the things, and then we escalated the points basically regarding this areas, and then we had slowly we came up to Zoom classes organized, and they were, after that, getting the knowledge, they were quite confident about the things what they need to do, and we made it a streamline. So with that regard, like, they got a direction how to take care of a patient and how to be a part of the preventional part of the thing with the HIV infection control part. So that is the thing what I wanted to talk about, ma'am, what we face the challenges. So that's it from my side, ma'am.
Thank you, Mona. You listed your challenges very well. I think they are very real challenges, because this is an enemy that we have not seen or heard before. So obviously we did not know what are the weapons to be used. So automatically there is a need to talk about the infection prevention practices, about what we were actually practicing anyway in hospital. What is new when it comes to mucormycosis. So I'm going to go to the nurses making a difference question to the last, and I'm just going to jump to Dr. Anita to, because that's an automatic question that needs to be addressed after Mona has shared all her challenges around infection prevention. We already we have emphasized that it is not a contagious disease, right? So I'm going to add one question to that before Dr. Anita takes to speak about infection prevention practices. Please also address, how about healthcare workers who are looking after these patients? If they are diabetic, you know, maybe they're not having 400 or whatever, but they're still diabetic, maybe not greatly controlled, or maybe they are taking some immunosuppressant medicines. And if they are assigned to mucor patients, will there be an added risk for the healthcare workers? That's one question that came to my mind while we were just talking about that. And generally, if you can just list down the practices that had to be looked into when this mucor hit us so badly in 2021, not as much because everything remained the same, but something happened this year. Yes, Dr. Anita, yes.
Thank you, Thankam, and please remind me if I miss out on some of these questions, right? So you talked about the infection control practices that needs to be put in place, right? And I would like to categorize them into two buckets. One is the infection control practices in the community, right? And second is in the hospitals, right? Because as we know that this is majorly a community-acquired pathogen, right? Disposer everywhere in the environment. And therefore, you know, we need to educate our patients, right? Public patients, how to protect themselves from this particular infection, right? So in that sense, you know, we already know what are the people who are more vulnerable to this particular disease. So remember that, you know, as I said, such patients, they need to be educated that they shouldn't really have any direct contact with the soil. Right. For example, if they had some soil handlers, some gardeners, or any such professions which mandates their close contact with environment or soil, they must protect themselves, right? They must wear long sleeve clothes, they must protect their body, close shoes and gloves and things like that. Also, they should not wear, visit the construction sites, because that is where there's a lot of, these spores get airborne, so that the concentration of these particular fungal spores in the environment is very high in the construction site. And that would hold true in the hospitals also. So they should not visit the construction sites. And most importantly, they should control the risk factors. The risk factors being the diabetes, that needs to be controlled well, because if you have diabetes, as always, you can't control environment, you can't control the spores. So you need to control yourself. And also, like, you know, for our clinical colleagues or people who are practicing, you know, sometimes self-medicating, also the overuse of steroids, because that was the single most important factor that happened during the COVID times, which led to the surge of this particular infection. The combination of COVID, steroids, and of course, the diabetes. So therefore, for the people, this education is extremely important. Should visit construction site. If you have a close environment, close contact with this environment kind of thing, keep yourself protected and control the risk factors. Now, also, you know, as Dr. Gaurav had, and I believe Dr. Sushin also said that, you know, a lot of people were home managed at home, and therefore how to take care of a respiratory therapy equipment. because fungus love anything which is moist, right? Which is, and where it can get some organic matter to multiply. So therefore, the respiratory therapy equipment, how they need to be kept, you know, they need to be kept dried, disinfected between users, kept in a closed kind of a dry, you know, a pouch or a packet or something like that. And again, the any kind of humidifiers, that needs to be sterile. That cannot be your normal tap water or anything like that. So this is from the community perspective and the home care perspective. And coming to the hospitals, I think what we really need to emphasize upon is the environmental hygiene and the infection control practices onto the patient. There's nothing very specific about MUCOR, right? You know, what we talk about infection control practices generally as a good practice is what needs to be practiced for these patients also, which means that, you know, nurses need to emphasize upon hand hygiene, right? The ANTT techniques, the antiseptic non-touch techniques, whenever they're handling the catheters, the ports and the sites and such, right? Again, the water that has to be used for humidifiers has to be sterile. And remember, you know, it's not that you keep you open a bottle and use it 4 days, 5 days, right? We say maximally single use bottles to be used and not to be used beyond 24 hours in any case. So it's not that you open a bottle and that it can, till it finishes, you keep on using that. So these are the small things that we recommend for a normal good practice also. It's not specific for MUCOR. And also, you know, one important thing that we often overlook is, you know, we have in our clean utilities or in the hospital premises, a lot of these cardboard boxes. We give no heed to that. We give no focus on these kind of things. Remember, these cardboard boxes can also be a good source of fungal spores because there is organic matter. There's a, you know, dust over. They have come from the warehouses. You know, apart from the other infections that can be a hazard from these cardboard boxes, even fungal spores can. They can be a source of that. Right? You know, and another is that a lot of false ceilings are used in our hospitals, right? So they are made of a material that absorbs a lot of moisture. So sometimes you see these tiles which are nicely stained. And this is also an area where these MUCOR and the aspergillus can really flourish. So be very aware of the environment wherever you are. Look for these kind of factors, you know, which can predispose the occurrence of the fungal spores. And yes, very important reason is the bandages I spoke to you about, right? So bandages have to be kept in a very clean utility, in a clean environment, and never cut your strips and hang it onto the side of any cupboard or any dressing trolley, anything to be used later on. Right, because they can attract fungal spores, and when you dress your wounds, you can actually deposit the spores over there. Another important factor which has come into light is the use of these tongue depressors, you know, this which are wooden tongue depressors. Sometimes they are also can get, because it's all wood, right? And wood has got some materials, and, you know, some kind of organic matter that can you know, allow the fungus to grow over there. So as nurses, this is what we need to be very mindful of. There's no rocket science here that we need to practice. It's the basic infection control practices that we often talk about that needs to be delivered on the patient. And the basic hygiene practices and the environmental practices are the key to you know, preventing these diseases. And one important thing, although nursing don't have a direct role into that, but they still need to be mindful of it, is the construction and renovation activities in the hospital. So, you know, we are always expanding. We are always short of spaces. You know, something is coming up, something is breaking down. So there's sometimes, you know, especially the old hospitals, because they need to keep pace with the changing requirements, a lot of construction activities happen. And remember, that is, again, one source of disrupting these spores in the environment. So whenever these construction activities happen, the hospital engineers need to be very, very careful about the risk assessment, how to protect the rest of the, you know, patients from getting these fungal spores. So there's a whole lot of engineering and science behind it, and that needs to be followed. And continuing to that, you know, aspect where the engineering can play a huge role is how to improve the indoor air quality. Now, most of our corporate hospitals are very well designed that way, right? You have a very strong system of air conditioning, ventilation, filtration, you know, so much so that, you know, we monitor our air quality through both engineering and microbiological controls. But in many other hospitals, such things may be non-existent, right? So that you know, is always will put the risk of getting this outdoor air into your hospital, and that out there, it depends on how contaminated or how clean your outdoor air is, so especially in the big areas, especially if there's some construction activity happening, there's every chance of fungal spores getting into your hospitals also. So the basic practices regarding disinfection. You know, most of the disinfectants can very easily kill the molds, right? Your hypochlorites are a very good agent. Your hydrogen peroxide is a very good agent. Your even ordinary ammonium compounds can act very effectively towards. So what are the common disinfectants that we use in our hospitals will work against these molds also. And for cleaning your hands, of course, it's the alcohol. That's the best agent that we need to worry about. And then even in OT, you have to subject your equipment as per the requirement. If they're critical equipment, you have to sterilize them either by autoclaving or ETO. And if it's semi-critical equipment like scopes, especially in the ENT services, you're using a lot of scopes in the OPD services, they need to be disinfected with an agent like a Cytex OPM, right? Very often I understand, I would like to hear from Dr. Sushin that later, that how does he manage in a very busy service, how does he manage to turn around the scopes for patients in the OPD service, making them clean. But this remains a challenge many a times, and in a very busy service, sometimes this can get compromised. As infection preventionists and as nursing team, we have to be very strong out here, not allow any compromises, and because, at times, although, there are scan reports in the literature on that, but the contaminated equipment, especially scopes and all, can also sometimes cause a seeding of these spores through a traumatic injury when you're doing any kind of scopies. So, all in all, these are the eight things that we need to be understanding, and that it's extremely important for the nurses to be aware of these kind of things, right? And we did ask about the question if any of the healthcare workers themselves is immunocompromised, right? So they are at risk for many other diseases, but getting a mucor from a patient is very unlikely. It's not a common scenario. It doesn't work that way. So it's not that the patient is shedding spores like airborne or something like that. They can get it independently from the environment, like just like any other immunocompromised patient, but not directly from managing the patient.
Great, that's great. And I think that's also a consolation for all the nurses sitting here, that they can look after the patients quite confidently as long as your infection control practices are good. Interestingly, don't you think that the COVID came and taught us all that we knew before a little bit more effective?
You better wash your hands, you better isolate, you better wear PPE.
This year it is teaching something else. When ICNs are trained, we talk about the construction, what needs to be. So they think, what is this? What big deal? Every day there is construction and nobody is asking permission what to do and all. This is what they discussed. Now suddenly the big mucor has come like a dinosaur and now it is looking at us, and then we are again talking about basics. That's really, really very interesting. Very well summarized. More questions are there around. Thank you so much, Dr. Anita. So, Bona, quickly, before I go to Dr. Sushin, quickly you tell me what are the, if you know that exactly what new practices you introduce. If you introduce anything, you should say, this is what we did. If you haven't, if you re-emphasize, then it's okay. If there is something new that you introduce, because as you said, the workload increase, the patient load increase, oxygen humidifiers and oxygen therapy equipments are not so much in supply. So there is I am from hospital, so I can just sit here and imagine what would be my challenge if I'm a nursing head. And I totally agree with you. So I'm interested to know that what are the new practices that you adopted since mucor came?
Yes, ma'am. So in regard to the challenges, what we faced, with that only the points, I will just go what we did for the alteration options to get into. So for the humidifiers, as I told that we were having back-to-back patients for COVID, and there was a lack of sending the humidifiers for ETOs and all. So in that context, like we had got an option like, why can't we just with the use of the RO water first, everyday basis or once the patient is discharged, take the humidifier before the another patient is shifted, just take the humidifier, wash with soap and water. But basically water also, we started to tell them to wash with RO water. So we took RO water, soap and RO water to wash it, dry it. And then before drying, we were just soaking it in the 1% hypochlorite for 15 to 20 minutes, and then drying it up, and then again connect it back to the oxygen supply. So that was the thing, that when we were having a lack of scarcity of humidifiers and where there was back-to-back patients flow. So instead of sending for the ETO, we got that option, and we were practicing to get back with the humidifier back for the ready for the patient. So that was the practice, new thing what we did. And regarding the to make it streamlined, ma'am, regarding the practices for infection control practices, just to, as Dr. Anita had described about, that is the basic things what we need to do. So we started, so we wanted our staffs to get into streamlined with the small, simplest things that we can do for the patients to prevent this mucormycosis. So we started cleaning as we started focusing on the cleaning part of the oxygen mask, cannulas, and also we started doing the audits and surveillance in a continuous way by different in charges. Second line, we had HIC champions. So they were there with us, and also our nursing superintendent. So all of us, we started to gear up with the auditing part, where we daily basis and with the rounds, whatever was happening, we started looking at the where the lack was happening. And we streamlined our nurses regarding how to take care and whether they are doing. We got the checklists for the humidifier, changing of the water, basically use of, we are practicing to RO water to use, but now after this case is increased, we stopped RO water and we started using sterile water. So that one thing also we started, instead of RO, we started adding up for humidifier, a sterile water. So that it was a continuous option. Then, with the audit made it more into practice, made the nurses to get into practice with the basic infection control practices, which can prevent for our patients to get into mucor, such part of the things. So that was something we did, ma'am. Not much, but this was something we had done. And related to, as I told, sample collection and all, we got the policy streamlined, and then we educated, and then things are going in a proper and a smooth way. So that was the thing. Yes, ma'am.
Great. What is the challenge around sample collection? What was the challenge related to mucor sample collection?
Yeah, ma'am. Actually, in initial, when they were not having the knowledge what exactly to be sent for the sample. So they were, when it is coming to rhino, so what exactly to be sent? So they were sending the nasopharyngeal swab. So that is not acceptable for the mucormycosis. It should be a scraping of the debris or the scraps what we are getting. So from there only we are taking the scraps, and then we are sending it in the saline, and then through in the saline in a sterile way we are sending to the lab. But initially we were having all that problems, that we were getting samples from nasopharyngeal swabs and all. So that we streamlined and made them understand how to get the samples get and how to transport it, in what solution it has to be taken.
I think that that kind of is a learning for a lot of people sitting here. So I'll go to Dr. Sushin. Thank you, Bona, for that. Dr. Sushin, I'll ask the question, but maybe you can add a little bit to Bona's answer about the sample collection. It would be good to know that how do we collect the sample properly and transport. And the question, is there a need for early nasal endoscopy in critically ill patients, especially post-COVID? And usually how many days post-COVID have you seen mucormycosis, setting in?
Yes, ma'am. So can I share my slide again? I think I have a couple of pictures there.
It's there. So I have not removed it yet.
Yeah, I can take it. So when we talk about nasal endoscopy is the cornerstone to getting an accurate diagnosis when we suspect a patient to have mucormycosis. Typically, it sets in between day 14 and day 21, that is second and third week after the affliction has happened. So we have made it a hospital protocol that every patient admitted with COVID into the wards or into the ICU will get an endoscopy, at least be offered an endoscopy before they step out of the hospital, even if they get discharged earlier. So typically we do an endoscopy when patient has very faint symptoms. So even if the patient says there is kind of a pricking sensation in the eye, or the patient feels heavy in the cheek, these may be vague, or a headache, which is the patient did not have before the COVID happened. Of course, COVID infection can itself lead to a headache as a symptom. But when the patient comes up with these seemingly vague complaints, we make it a point to offer them a nasal endoscopy. So other than these, this has been spoken about before as well. The typical symptoms of mucormycosis are one-sided cheek swelling, swelling of the eyeball, redness of the eyeball, complaints in terms of diminution of vision, sometimes loss of vision, unexplained loss of vision, unexplained headaches, loosening of teeth. There is anesthesia around the cheek. Patient starts feeling numb around the cheek or around the upper lip, because the infraorbital nerve, which comes out of the cheek, is one of the most common nerves affected with mucormycosis. Sometimes patients can also have a palatal ulceration. So along with this, when a patient says that, you know, there is a one-sided nose block or one-sided dirty nasal discharge, sometimes blood tinged, definitely it makes sense to give a patient a more detailed examination. So just to give you a small preview into how this patient looks, you can see this gentleman on the left side had a early sinonasal mucormycosis along with the periorbital swelling. You can see that there's lid edema. This is the early indication of orbital cellulitis. The same gentleman had a palatal ulcer as well. When we did a more detailed examination, he had this palatal ulcer. So this gentleman came with, these photos have been put up with prior permission, of course. This gentleman came with left-sided total ophthalmoplegia. So when a patient says that his vision is gone, you know, you don't dismiss it as a trivial symptom. Please take a good second look. They might be having fixation of the eyeball. We call them frozen eyeballs. So, and this gentleman had to undergo orbital excentration, as you can see on the other picture on the right side. And then, you know, he has lived to tell his story. So the victory we have had is that he has lived to tell his story. This picture on the right side of the screen has been taken about a month approximately, I think, post-operatively. So when a patient says eyeball swelling, headache, especially in the setting of mucormycosis, please, in the setting of COVID, I'm sorry. So let us give it due credence and give it a more detailed examination. Yes, nasal endoscopy, it can be done bedside. But we offer endoscopies even at the COVID ICU, the COVID wards. And as Sister Bona was talking about, sample collection blindly by a nursing personnel might be a bit of a challenge and might lead to some kind of a negative reporting also, because even as ENT surgeons, we're not able to take blind samples. So we must have some kind of a guided sample. The best way to sample is putting a camera, putting an endoscope. We have a separate endoscopic trolley system dedicated in the hospital for muco patients. We use and we sterilize the scopes quite robustly. So when you put an endoscope, you're able to look into those areas. We call that area as the middle meatus. Middle meatus is the area where the maxillary sinus opens. That is kind of the highway or the meeting point of various sinuses in the nasal cavity. When you look at that area and when you sample from that area, it is likely to be very representative. And also conversely, if a patient complains of the symptoms we spoke about while, and this area is fairly clear and your suspicion is low, you could also wait for a day or two. So, but nowadays anxiety level is so high, the moment we say the endoscopy is clear also, patients are coming forward and asking for a further evaluation. We end up offering them MRI of the nose, brain and the orbits, plane and contrast, that is the standard of diagnostic options available. We back up our endoscopy if negative with an MRI scan. So this at least gives us a fair amount of evidence about whether the patient is having some kind of a fungal affliction or not.
Ankam, can I just add a thing to what Dr. Sushin just said regarding the sampling bit? May I, with your permission?
Yes.
Yeah. So a very important point was highlighted both by Bona and Dr. Sushin, that sampling is extremely important. And I think it has to be usually done by the doctors only, because they know where to collect the samples from. The sample should be sent to the laboratory in a normal saline in a sterile container. Why sterile? Because we want to culture it also. And, the diagnosis of mucor is very simple. It just takes, a microscopy of maybe 20, 30 minutes or even lesser. You just put the slide, some KOH mount, and you just see it under the microscope. And if you have hit the right sample, you can actually, tell the diagnosis within 30 minutes to the treating doctor. So that is so easy. You don't need very fancy stains or anything like that. It's a direct microscope in a KOH sphere, provided the sample has been sent adequately. And many times you've seen that, there's a high clinical index of suspicion and you're not finding the mucor in the sample. You keep on going back to the lab, look for more, because, sometimes it's not so easy to find also. So you have to sample, sometimes study a large amount of sample before you can actually find these, mucor in the sample. And culture, of course, is required, not mandatory, but it is done to understand what the species are. But just a word of caution here that, sometimes the culture hit rate is not that high. It is more easily seen under the microscope than it grows into the culture, because the structure of this hyphae is such that, we often say it's a broad aseptate ribbon-like hyphae. That means it doesn't have any septation in the fungal wall, which adds support to it. So when you send the sample, when you process it, you end up tearing the fungus. And since it doesn't have a good skeletal system inside, it collapses. And therefore, we are not able to grow it very well on the culture medium. So always on a normal saline, never swabs. Remember, for fungus and tuberculosis, swabs are the samples which should be rejected by the laboratory. We don't accept nasopharyngeal swabs, either for fungus or for mycobacterium tuberculosis. This is two mistakes often done by the nurses and even the young resident doctors, where they just send these swabs and they expect, and I think it's absolutely important for the lab to reject these samples and inform the people of the correct sample which is required. So I just wanted to emphasize, thank you so much, Dr. Sushin and Nona, for highlighting these points.
Great, thank you so much. There's a lot of learning there, because at least I was not aware of that. Before I move on to the next question, and before I forget, Dr. Sushin, Dr. Anita wanted you to comment on the disinfection of scopes when you have high volume procedures happening and you are using endoscopes so frequently because you have large volume. So how do you ensure that they are disinfected? Even in regular time, scopes used to be a headache for us. And Dr. Anita knows that also. We are like going with our nose everywhere trying to figure out how the scopes can be kept sterile between patients. So maybe you would like to answer that before I go to, Dr. Gaurav.
So quite ironically, so to say, for a problem created by a Chinese virus, the Wuhan virus, so to say, we have purchased 6 sets of cheap Chinese endoscopes, which we recycle, rapidly in the outpatient and the, we have a nurse dedicated. In fact, as Dr. Anita was pointing out, the microbiologist is a very important person in our team. In fact, in this photo that I just showed you, in which the gentleman underwent an orbital excentration, she gave me the report. The patient was on the table. He came in late night. I remember this gentleman, he came from Andhra Pradesh. He came in late night. We didn't have much time because his eyes was looking really bad and he was not, he had severe symptoms. Sugars were almost 400 plus. So I requested Dr. Uma. She heads our microbiology wing in our Fortis Hospital there. And I sent the sample across. She told me it's aseptate broad filaments in half an hour's time. That could enable me to counsel the patient for an orbital excentration. Without a proper diagnosis, I cannot take off a patient's eyeball. Right? So that critical point, she gave me the report in half an hour. Of course, the biopsies and the frozens would take much longer. Yes, the histopathology is more likely to reflect a stromal invasion or an angioinvasive nature, as Madam mentioned. We have had n number of slides wherein they have been able to demonstrate vascular vessel invasion on the slides, that takes time. So sometimes we have taken in patients for surgery as early as 2 hours within them presenting to us if they're nil by mouth, and sometimes, you know, we take an emergency consent. So doing that sampling well and getting it reported by a good competent clinician, microbiologist in this case, is very, very important decision making. So yes, the answer to Anita's question is yes, we have 6 sets of endoscopes, so which initially we used to have one, and Fortis management has been kind enough to buy us those additional sets of endoscopes which they normally don't do. So so we have, and I have 2 sets of my own to add to that. So we have 8 sets. So we are able to recycle them. Yes, when we have a chance, we ETO them. When we are hard pressed for time, we put it in Cydex solution. That for about half an hour's time, I think is a fair level of acceptance. And then we top it up with cleaning them with sterilium before we dry them before we use it on the next patient. Most often we are able to EO them and then we use them.
So Dr. Sushil, can I just ask you one question? Do you need a different suite for mucormycosis patients other than your regular ENT patients at the OPD? Do you need to have a special chamber or like a different endoscopy?
No, madam. We have a regular procedure room which is hardly used now because our elective work is almost zero. In the last 6 weeks, I mean, in fact, yesterday was the first time I operated on an elective case after postponing that for about 1.5 months. So we have one OPD suite and one procedure room dedicated for ENT. We use the procedure room where we have the entire the endoscopy tray, our endoscopy trolley. So I don't see the regular patient and the suspect mucor patient in the same OPD. There is not much scientific reason to that. Yes, they can be seen. Just that having the endoscopic trolley, my Cydex tray, and my nurse who's dedicated to that procedure room makes things more easy for me, because they know they pick up the samples quickly. They know they put a part into saline, a part into formalin, and then everything is streamlined. So for the sake of convenience, I have the entire setup in a procedure room in the outpatient department.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sushin. Very, very informative. And we are boosting their economy by buying so many scopes from them.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think it's about time we made some Indian endoscopes as well. I've spoken to a manufacturer saying, sasta wala endoscope bana dena.
Yeah, I know. Made in India, we need very quickly. Yeah. So Dr. Gaurav, are you there?
Yes, Rangam, I'm there.
Okay, the slide is on.
Yeah, you can remove the
mic. I'm so sorry. Yeah.
I am, before that, let me ask, why are you having goggles, dark goggles?
So I am also suffering from keratoconus uveitis, and hence I'm not able to come onto the screen and I have to avoid the glare. Hence, I'm very at night.
No. I think Dr. Gaurav is photosensitive to the talk on amphotericin.
I thought, you get those, emoticons, no? You can stick on to your face. I thought, he's playing with that or what, I thought, let me not ask. Again, when I am looking at him, he's again wearing that. I said, oh God, everybody will be wondering what happened to Dr. Gaurav. Raat ko ye chashma laga rahe kala wala. So
the truth is, I think that they suit him really happy. Well.
Ankam, sab celebrity daat ko bhi chashma lagaye. You know that, na? The airport look and all, yeah. So, Gaurav is no less.
So, Bechara, he has got photosensitivity, glare sensitivity. Oh my God, too much of screen time. So, Dr. Gaurav, with your permission, I'm going to rephrase your question, because you already answered that amphotericin at home and how you are preparing them. So I have a unique question. So you have looked after so many patients at home in COVID, and you have used oxygen concentrators, oxygen cylinders at home. Now, among those patients, were there anyone who actually got mucor? And do you think that there was something that in home, something could have gone amiss that, this time, the $1 million question is coming to all of you in a while. because I have written it down. I said, why didn't I think of this before? So I'm going to ask all of you in a while that question. So what do you think, you know, that because you have so much exposure in the home, that is the community, and most of the patients who are coming to hospital that I understand, Mucor is community acquired. There are very few hospital acquired Mucor. So where do you think could be the challenge lying in the community and at home?
So I think a very, very valid question, Thankam. As Dr. Dutt said that we are fueling the Chinese economy by buying more scopes, we did the same by buying many more oxygen concentrators. So in this wave of COVID, I think we must have procured more than 500 concentrators, which we had to put at home because of the situation which you saw in Delhi, and not only in Delhi, in Bangalore also, in Bombay also, and to a degree in Chandigarh and Kolkata also, although lesser degrees. Now, when you, there was a time when all the oxygen concentrators or cylinders for that were being used only on maybe ventilated patients at home or patients who required oxygen therapy due to lung fibrosis or prolonged lung diseases, right? So it was a very controlled cohort of patients. And because not many people know, we are the first accredited home healthcare organization. So we also have an infection control manual and we also have an infection control nurse. So all the nurses who were dealing with oxygen were trained specifically to handle the oxygen, which it becomes a very important tool or an equipment at home where you have to take care of the sterilization, take care of moving from one patient to the other, troubleshooting, breakdown, backups, all these things. We don't have these piped gases at home. Having said that, when all this happened, I think the most important thing here was that doctors, I always say that doctors spend a few minutes with the patients. It is the nurses who are always educating, preventing, counseling, and guiding the patients. And in our case, a nurse stays either for 12 hours or, and in some cases in COVID, it was 24 hours also. So one, training these nurses on the educational aspects itself was very, very important. Now, these educational aspects were not only for COVID patients, these were non-COVID patients also. As I said, we have a lot of immunocompromised patients, whether it is elderly, whether it is diabetic, whether it is post-transplant, right? And we had to train our nurses that how do you maintain your sugars? How do you get them to see their doctors? How do you identify those early warning signs and get to a doctor rather than waiting? So this was one part of the whole training in non-COVID patients. In the COVID patients, we had a post-COVID touch base with the patients where again we were training. And, and we had to literally come out with specific protocols on handling of oxygen concentrators. Thanks to the government, cylinders were not available for home, right? All cylinders were routed to the hospital. So that one problem was taken care of. But a concentrator, how to handle the humidifier, where to get the distilled water or sterile water, what all to do, those all protocols. And then because we are in a distributed environment, we can't get all the nurses by the ICN into a room and train. We made videos. We did webinars with experts like Dr. Anita and many more to convince our nurses and patients also that what are the best practices. And because the fear factor was good enough, we were able to do that. So through webinars, through trainings in Center of Excellence, videos, checklist, even video audits, we were able to ensure that whatever training we had done, those protocols are being implemented. But the sad part is that we could control only what we could, where our people or we had a reach. And oxygen has been rampantly used during this this pandemic. Every person thought that it was an air purifier or it was a vacuum cleaner, which they could buy. And they knew how to use it. Google will tell them. And they did a lot of wrong things, which I feel will lead to this mucormycosis endemic at some point of time. But in our own control environment at home or outside the hospital, in hotels or wherever we did, we were able to implement very stringent procedures. In fact, wherever we were even selling an oxygen concentrator, we were giving a handbook and videos with that how you should use it and when you should seek medical help. So if that answers the question. You're on mute, Thankam.
Yeah, I muted myself to have a small cough. So definitely you answered the question. So rampant use of, you know, oxygen concentrators and initial cylinders. I had been part of not getting anything for anyone who was asking me for help, whether it is a nurse or a concentrator or a bed or a cylinder. I also always had to cut a sorry figure because nobody could. And Dr. Gaurav had a very long, lovely message if you are trying to reach him. Now that message has changed at the peak of Mucor, you know. I am busy helping someone in the best way I can, so I'll get back to you. It's a long one. I said, that's very sweet of him, telling me very nicely, don't bother me, I have enough on my plate. So anyway, I think you all did a fantastic job.
I printed that message after 3 days of helplessness. My phone was ringing continuously and we had no supplies. In fact, I would like to share this with the other panelists also. One day morning at 6:30, I woke up and I called my CEO that we are not doing our bit right. There are so many patients with oxygen saturation of 80 to 90 who are going round and round in ambulances and no hospital is accepting them. What do we do about that? And he said, okay, what can we do? I said, we can manage these people on 5 liters of oxygen. At least they will get some leverage before they get a bed into the hospital or they'll recover. And he said, how do you want to do it? I said, I want to do it in a very controlled environment where at least I have trained doctors, nurses, lab, pharmacy, even 10 liter oxygen and 40 liter oxygen cylinders so that if we need to ramp it up, we can ramp it up. He said, what is the risk? I said, there is only one risk. This is not as per government guidelines because government guidelines still says 90%. The situation is an emergency. You can go to jail. And my CEO was brave enough to say, please do this to save lives. We'll see what happens. And we were able to save lives. So I think we all have stepped out of the way to save lives. And that is one message I very clearly I want to give. If you have to choose between what is wrong, what is right, and a life, I think life matters the most. I don't know how Dr. Dutt would be feeling by taking out so many eyes and so many disfiguring. It's not a good feeling. This pandemic, I think we have had so many people dying and we knew in the families also that this is happening. So that's again another message that whatever we can contribute.
Just a second, Dr. Gaurav. Donna Simon, please stop sharing. Thank you. I think they're trying to practice because I've given the sharing this one. Yes, Dr. Shushin.
On a lighter note, as Dr. Gaurav was saying, we had a lot of Bahubali patients that came in carrying their own cylinder. They came in from the rural side, you know, with the mask on, you know, 5 liters, you know, their own fancy tuning, you know, they came carrying their own cylinder. Then I said, and asked them, who set the oxygen for you? No, we don't know. It is just running.
So the cartoon that came was actually real. In reality, it happened.
They came carrying on a wheelchair, carrying their own cylinders. So.
That's really interesting. So, Dr. Afreen, my question to you now, the last one, after that we will take the regular questions from the audience and the questions that I have got, is that we are kind of aware of the morbidity that goes on with Mucor. What has been the mortality and morbidity that you experienced this year? You know, I'm sure that Dr. Shushin would also know that if you get 100 Mucor patients now, how many of them are going to go home losing some part of their body, you know? And how about the mortality? What happens? Do they convert into fungicemias and, you know, they take that route and do they die? Dr. Afreen, can't hear. I think you need to join with the audio. By the time Dr. Afreen comes back, let me bounce the question off to Dr. Shushin, and that what has been your experience of mortality and morbidity?
Yeah. So, in summary, we have treated 128 patients with the surgical requirement till date in the last about 5 to 6 weeks, precisely. We have had 14 orbital excentrations. We've had 18 maxillectomies. 2 patients developed stroke after surgery. 8 of them were counseled and we we refused surgery to them because they had significant intracranial complications. Patients came in with temporoparietal occipital infarcts. The only two patients that came walking, talking to us with brain abscesses, one of them had an abscess in the frontobasal area. Interestingly, that turned out to be invasive aspergillosis. Anita, ma'am, I think that might be of interest to you. As you were saying, this lady, in fact, she got discharged today. A 65-year-old lady, she contracted COVID, and then the same profile, sugars being high, and then the scan showing fungal disease. We operated on her. To me, on table, intraoperatively, it looked just like another mucus. KOH, cultures, histopathology, everything pointed toward the Aspergillus niger. So we were quite surprised, and we have today discharged her on voriconazole. So I was really scared and skeptical. I was unwilling to stop Amfo-B for her amphotericin B after the surgery. Today, after about, I think it's day 9 probably, she walked out of the hospital with the promise that she'll come back to us every third day for a follow-up. So we have, touch wood, so far we have not had patients that died after surgery. Most of the patients that went away were the ones that were not operated on because they had intracranial complications at presentation to us. Having said that, we have had our share of issues. Patients that did well initially, we have had patients that needed redebridement and with some extension into the patient that came with limited maxillary disease, came back with disease in the infratemporal pterygopalatine fossa, much at the back of the nose. We had to reoperate them. Some patients who were really doing really well initially, and then they came with swelling of the premaxilla. They came with palatal, they came with loose teeth, you know, palatal softening, and then we had to do what we call alveolectomies, limited removal of the sockets of the teeth. Along with some patients had progressed, we had to do what we call as an infrastructure maxillectomy, wherein we take off the lower half of the maxilla. So some patients who were initially, the eyes were preserved, then they had the intraorbital complications, the disease progressed into the orbit, into the intracondylar compartment. We had to do orbital excentrations on say day 5, day 6 after surgery. It's too early to say, to talk about the long-term outcomes, but so far I would say, in general, their behavior, the behavior of COVID-associated mucormycosis patients that have been operated on has been much better than the regular cohort of patients that used to develop mucor in the pre-COVID era. The pre-COVID era, they used to come in really bad. To be honest, my outcomes have been not been very encouraging. Out of the 50-odd patients that I had operated on before the COVID happened, we lost almost half of them. I think there were 27 deaths out of 50 patients that we had treated in the last some time. But since COVID is a transient phenomenon, with once the COVID gets better, once the sugars get better, I think somehow the immunity comes back and immunity gets better, and then the patients spring back, albeit with a lot of residual deformities, residual deficits, so to say. You know, with maxilla, we need to give them a maxillary obturator. They need some kind of immediate rehabilitation, and then they talk about long-term rehabilitations, which we are able to talk to them only after 3 to 4 months. So there are many questions which are unanswered, but so far mortality in our series has been low. That has been the experience has been similar in many other groups that are operating actively in Bangalore. But as I said, it is perhaps too premature to declare and sign off on that. Maybe we will get back with more data 3 months down the line, once we have been able to compile all of it.
What would be the, though it is not totally authentic, what would be the percentage of mortality that you would like to place, you know, around?
I would say between 7% and 8%. That's what we had a discussion just today. I was on another panel. So the approximate ballpark figure we arrived at was about 7% to 8% mortality overall.
That would be, what is the mortality rate of COVID this year in
COVID,
comparison?
COVID mortality is, I think, 1.5 to 2%, I think, is the COVID mortality. Yes, overall, yes. In the Indian picture, right? 1.8% to be precise. So in that sense, the mortality for mucor is quite high, but given the devil that mucor is, I think definitely even 7-8% mortality is I would say is acceptable in the minds of operating doctors.
Yeah, I think for healthcare workers, yeah. Dr. Afrin, can you speak? You are still not audible. What you can do, Dr. Afrin, can you unmute now? Yes? Dr. Afrin, maybe you need to log out and log in again. Might be better. We are already at 9 and we still have a few more questions. So we'll go through the questions very quickly so that we can answer them and we are not delaying the session also too long. So Dr. Sushin, you had one question here. Did all 1,000 cases needed surgical intervention? What's the percentage?
Yes, madam. In the sense, 1,000 is a ballpark figure of all the... There are about... In Bangalore alone, there are about 8 to 9 groups of ENT surgeons that are performing mucormycosis surgeries. Given the fact that the debridement is the first step, and without debridement, there is no role for antifungals. All these patients that I spoke about, approximately 1,000 plus, have received surgery in the last 6 weeks.
And all this data that is you're talking about the peer group, all of them will eventually get published, right?
Yeah. We are working on three different. We are working with three separate groups. Eventually, the data will come out in more than one platform, I think.
And the question here: what are precautions to be taken? Who are taking care of mucor that has been already answered, and someone has suggested oral hygiene has to be maintained. So while we are looking at oral hygiene, provide gargles, low sugar diet, high protein. So this is steam inhalation can be a double-edged weapon, as Dr. Sushin already mentioned. Too much of steam destroys our natural defense, and that could make the area more vulnerable, the mucous membrane more vulnerable to get this, you know, mucor in susceptible patients, right? That's what has been discussed. So I'm kind of summarizing them. And there was one case that yesterday somebody was discussing, very well-educated person and professional, and sitting at home and post-COVID landed with mucor. Can that happen? Very well-placed. Yeah. It is living in a... You can say in a very high-end colony and supposed to be great hygiene and everything, but even they came. So what's happening?
So there was some indirect evidence wherein, I'm sorry, it was a question to me. I'm sorry. I didn't.
Anybody can answer, no problem. Yeah.
So what happened was there was a gentleman, 70 plus. So he's been home, not moved an inch from his room in the last 7-8 months. Apparently, there was a small bout of fever, which he didn't pay much attention to. He was a diabetic. The fever seemed to have subsided, but he never got a COVID test done. And then he developed a cheek swelling. Then we retrospectively, we did a COVID antibody check on him. That seemed high because he was unvaccinated. The gentleman was unvaccinated, but his COVID antibody was high. And the disease turned out to be mucor. So mucor can spring surprises from any corner of practically out of nowhere. So let us not say it's never possible to any patient that is under the scanner for as a mucus suspect. It has sprung surprises to us from all directions. So let us keep our eyes wide open. Let us be more open to the possibilities of a patient who's not stepped out or anywhere to contact me.
Gaurav, yes, he's raised his hands. And then Dr. Anita.
I think mucor is being a very, very big proponent of social justice. It is not discriminating, whether it is high-end people or low-end people or whosoever. The only thing which mucor is saying is that maintain your immunity, and that can be done only by one thing today, that is vaccination. So all the people who are still thinking whether they should get vaccinated or not vaccinated, especially the nurses, you can't do that. You have to get vaccinated and get whatever vaccination you get at the earliest, because that's the only thing which will make your immunity shield and mucor will vanish.
Absolutely.
Now, but there are also outliers. Just now, Dr. Sushin said this gentleman had enough antibodies. Still, he got...
No, he didn't have vaccination. He said that this person was...
But he had antibodies.
Yeah. He had some antibodies. So he had some antibody, but he had never tested himself for COVID. The diabetes being high, I think while he was still in the recovery phase of the COVID, wherein we get some antibodies, it picked up the mucor as well. So let us not have any hesitancy in term, at least I would that would be a big take home message from this webinar, at least to all the nurses who are really, really important to all of us. Please don't hesitate to vaccinate yourself and your family members. For the statistic, 85% of the patients that we have operated for mucormycosis were unvaccinated. And let me emphasize that again.
I think it's very, very important.
It's a very vital stat. And another important thing, as Dr. Anita pointed out, mucor is not contagious. So let us not, when we offer healthcare to a patient with mucormycosis, let us not be scared, because it does not spread from person to person. So let's take it off our minds.
Dr. Anita was going to say something. I'll put a question also there. Can we consider mucor as opportunistic infection? And if they develop in the hospital, will you call it as hospital acquired infection? Or how will you call it? You know, so you're adding something to them. You can answer this question also.
Yeah, so Spango, mucor is an opportunistic infection. It doesn't impact you and me, people who are healthy hosts. We're able to fight it off, right? So it's only a very vulnerable population which is going to get it. So therefore, it's definitely an opportunistic infection. And as I said, technically, it used to be community acquired, but there are episodes, there are instances where it can get acquired in the hospital also, right? Very specifically from your, but we have seen burns patient getting treated in the hospital, developing mucormycosis because of the, bad plasters and things like that. And also the mask, the respiratory therapy equipment is very important, maintaining its cleanliness, hygiene, disinfection, sterilization, but it's more important from the perspective of bacterial infections more than fungal infections. I mean, I don't think we have seen a huge amount of literature where masks and all, at least in the hospital setting, have been implicated for mucor as per se, right? For bacterial infections, for sure, yeah. But yes, as per infection control practices, it needs to be taken care of in the manner. And here, again, humidifiers was being talked about a lot. And just to, make very clear that, they need to be disinfected, sterilized, whatever methods that you're adopting between patients, for sure. And even if the same patient is admitted there for a longer period of time, at least twice a week, even on the same patient. So this is one thing we need to focus on about the cleanliness of the humidifiers things. And what I was basically wanting to say was responding to your question where you said that person never went out. The person doesn't have to go out. The fungus is everywhere. They'll come. You open. You leave a bread inside your fridge. Sometimes you start seeing fungus was growing into that. They'll come with your packets and cardboards and things like that. So they're everywhere. It's very difficult to kind of, unless you have a HEPA-filtered room, where you can ensure an absolute stringent, air quality, you cannot avoid these spores from not reaching you. And the piece about vaccine is very, very valid. And what vaccine is going to do, it's going to cut the transmission of COVID. And we know COVID is in itself a risk factor for mucormycosis. And although we haven't seen some research happening into that, but I was hearing Dr. Chakraborty the other day, and he's the leading mycologist of a country, and he was saying that there seems to be an independent predisposition also towards both diabetes and mucormycosis. So therefore, vaccination is going to definitely reduce the risk, and my young colleagues over there need to understand that vaccine, and that's the COVID vaccine. And last but not the least, Thankam, I really want to thank you for not calling it a black fungus, but that has been reported in print media and news media so often.
Not only black, my help at home who is watching the news, because I stopped watching news. So she came and asked me, Didi, what is the difference between black fungus, yellow fungus and white fungus? I said, what? So I just asked, what? Then I said, ye sab media wale bol rahe ki don't pay attention. So fungus hai aur kuch nahi hai, But I think if you open the literature, the pictures that we see are not very comforting. So we can imagine the, even what Dr. Sushin showed today. I was in another webinar. I think it was Dr. Gaurav's webinar on mucor. I don't know. So many pictures were showed. There was completely medical, webinar. That was Fortis one. I remember. Yeah. There were so many photos were shown. And when you look at that, you really, really feel for them and you really get scared also. So there is one question here. Once the patient completed antifungal therapy and get recovered from mucor, is there any chance of recurrence? Dr. Afrin, would you like to take that question? I think you are still not audible. We are so unlucky today. Something, can you check your audio and see whether you are connected by audio? Somebody can take that question. Is Dr. Shashin, do you think that it can recur if you have had MUCR once? And
so once the current recommendation for a sinonasal MUCR mycosis with plus or minus orbital excentrations between about 3.5 grams of total therapy of liposomal amphotericin B, it can go up to 4-4.5 when there is a cerebral component, when it spreads to the brain. Once this course is completed, typically the patient is lucky to get all the doses, which most of them have not so far. It takes between 12 and 15 days to complete the course. After this course, we do what is called as a surveillance scan, especially if the patient is symptomatic in terms of a headache or any other symptoms that they complain of. We do a surveillance MRI to check the extent of disease preoperatively and also on the MRI 2 weeks down. That's one benchmark from where we decide on further therapy. I always continue my patients on oral posaconazole for at least a month and a half to 3 months. The pre-COVID era, the recommendation was posaconazole maintenance therapy anywhere between 3 to 18 months. In fact, the patients that we treated last year, they were on treatment up till about 2-3 months ago. Then we did a scan and one of them was not doing so well. Then we restarted the posaconazole. So one thing I would say that the literature support in terms of how long to continue therapy is not very well defined. I think especially in the Indian scenario, I think we should take this opportunity as a community and doctors and all of us together, nurses and all of us together, to lay down the guidelines, at least in the Indian context. So we, at this stage, we are our oldest MUCR patient for the season is about 45 to 50 days old. Patients are discharged on posaconazole, assuming that they have completed the full 3.5 gram of amphotericin B. We still continue them on posaconazole 300 mg maintenance dose for at least a month and a half. So, and sometimes much longer. Isavuconazole is a better option to posaconazole for mucormycosis. Unfortunately, isavuconazole is not as freely available as posaconazole. In fact, there's only one brand of isavuconazole in India, which is marketed by Pfizer. Not easily available, more expensive than posa. So we are resorting to posaconazole. And
there is comment here that the medicine is also not available nowadays.
Yeah, it's an absolute nightmare. In fact, as I'm talking to the webinar, I have 3 messages saying that amphotericin B name is right. So
it's the same thing like last year.
Same thing across. Same thing across, across India, I think.
No? So there is not related to MUCOR, there's a question. Though I know the answer, but I would like one of you to answer. Can lactating mother take the vaccination? Since the vaccination topic came, so they are asking, can lactating mothers take vaccination for COVID?
Yes, they can.
What I wanted
they
to
should, tell they should.
There are myths around, you know, when you are having periods, don't go and take it. This is all, you know, in the head. So we literally have to tell. I think it's the best that you ask the question, and that is what it is. And I think my million-dollar question is this to all of you. We had COVID last year. We had spores everywhere. We had asbestos in the hospital. We had very sick patients. Why that this year MUCOR is attacking so badly? I have my own assumptions, but you people are in the hospital. So I keep on making my own hypothesis ki ye aisa hua hoga. I know nobody has all the answers now because it's too early to say. But there is a distinct difference between 2020 and 2021. The audience who got COVID was also different. Mortality rate was higher than last year. And then this MUCOR came. So what is it telling us? You know, that's the million-dollar question I wanted to ask before we can say bye to everyone. I still have a few more questions. Some of them are already answered. Yeah.
So,
yes, anyone.
So, okay, since all of us are required to put our two bits here, I think it was one, the sheer number of cases, you know, the exponential number that we saw this time, both diagnosed and undiagnosed, right? Second was, you know, the rampant use of steroids, you know, the non-availability of beds, you know, it created such a fear psychosis amongst all the clinical fraternity as well as the patients. And we know that so many people, you know, self-medicated, they took steroids and very high doses of steroids, you know. And I think as clinician also, Dr. Sushil would agree with me that a lot of, you know, our doctors also went overboard with steroids, right? Whereas much against the guidelines, whether it was fear, whether it was non-availability of the resources that propelled them to do that, you know. So these are the two major factors, right, that really catapulted the numbers to this high number. And that is the only thing I can think of. Otherwise, rest, everything remains the same. So excessive use of steroids, more sugars, you know, sugar control went haywire terribly. And these are the bedrocks for mucor to proliferate.
Is there any common factor with the mucor by the age-wise, like COVID this time were more prevalent in, you know, younger age groups? They were getting COVID. Last year it was elderly population. So this year we are saying they were not vaccinated, so they became the target this year. So for mucor, is there any age prevalence that you are observing?
Yeah, we have in the second wave, yes, the mucor is seen typically between the ages of 35 and 55. The youngest we have treated is a 23-year-old lady, and the oldest we have treated is a 90-year-old gentleman. So typically, I would say, as we spoke, the unvaccinated lot are the ones that are coming with the chunk of infections.
Yeah. So loud and clear, my friends, don't say unvaccinated. You must get vaccinated. That is the message that you should take home for yourself and for your loved ones. And Dr. Afrin, can I hear you? I think today is not your... Not your day. I think we really have a problem. I think we will have this last question. Patients, those who have severe fluid restriction and disease condition like CKD and ILD, can skip the saline flush before and after. Can they? I think that was Dr. Afrin who had told. But you can type your answer if you can hear me. You can type your answer.
Yeah.
The question is about the CKD. Are you able to hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. You can type the answer for that. They're saying that if there is fluid restriction, how will you give them the pre-fungal medicines preload, the fluid, you know? So we are already 9:20. I was going to wrap up at 9, and we still have 182 people sitting here and listening. So it kind of tells, you know, the inquisitiveness, the curiosity to learn about this. So I think there are still questions are coming. While I look at the last question, I would like to ask each one of you, what is your parting summarization? I know that it's a very basic thing. Like you said, it was existent every time and everywhere, but I never saw one. So for me, it is a very novel disease. I only read about it, aspergillosis little bit. I think I have one case I have seen in my entire, life of being a nurse. So I think a very, very fantastic discussion. I'll come to thanking each one of you in a minute. Just your final discussions. Yes, I'll start with Dr. Anita.
Well, I think enough has been said today, but the parting message would be that, one is get educated yourself about this disease, right? Educate your peers, colleagues, and also the patients about this, right? Not just the mucor, but also the COVID. And second is get vaccinated. So nothing to fear about. It's not contagious. We can manage it. The disease, when diagnosed early, can be managed well. So awareness is key, both in the public domain as well as the nursing fraternity. So have these education sessions within your own hospitals, within your own fraternity. Very important to tell everybody about this. And back to the basics, adhere to the infection control practices at the bedside. Extremely important.
I think while we are discharging COVID patients, we have to now start educating them how to watch out for mucor so that they come on time and get to see a ENT doctor. This is what I understood from all that I was reading, that get early, get examined by an ENT just to make sure that it is not mucor that is starting to brew up there. Dr. Gaurav?
My only message is that 16th of January, India opened up the vaccination for healthcare workers. If any healthcare worker is still not vaccinated, it's not only criminal, but you are being unfair to your loved ones. Who will get this infection if you get it from anywhere? So get vaccinated ASAP. That's my only message to the whole fraternity.
Okay. Thank you very much. So Dr. Afrin has answered, it's preferable to hydrate the individual before, there's a lot of thank you coming. Hydrate the individual before usage of amphotericin B, an alternative drug, isavuconazole, can be used in these circumstances. So clinician can decide to use a different antifungal in case there is food restriction. This is what I understand. Am I right, Dr. Afrin? Right? Yeah. Okay. Great. Now we have sign language also happening here. Thank you so much. You can type in your last message, what you want to tell the team here, because we are going to wrap up. I will save the last bit for Dr. Shushin. I had been troubling him with a lot of questions. So Bona, what was your experience of being in the panel, and what would you like to tell now to the audience while we wrap it up?
Okay. Ma'am, I'm actually very much excited and happy, and I enjoyed this panel discussion actually too much. And I'm looking forward for such more coming up for me from through you or somewhere else also, that I can gain much more knowledge. And as being a panelist over here, but I have heard a lot and I have gained lot knowledge regarding whatever the discussions happened. And for the key as a message, one thing we want to just say, like it, we were just talking about, is regarding basics. We have to go on to the basics. We have to start. COVID and mucormycosis has shown us that we need to not neglect the basic things what we need to do for the patient. Instead of going through the rocket science and going to the higher level, we have to start from the basic, and then stepwise we have to go with the infection control if we see in that part regarding it. And as Dr. Anita has already concluded with all the things, vaccination, awareness, that was all in my mind, it was going on. So it's already compiled together and spoken by Dr. Anita. So that is from my side, ma'am.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Bona. And Dr. Shushin, your last few words for this panel discussion. Dr. Afrin is typing. I'm only trying to read.
It's already been well summarized by Dr. Anita and Dr. Gaurav. Vaccinate yourself. Don't be scared of mucor. Let's aim for an early diagnosis. And we as a community, doctors, nurses, and all of us, healthcare at home, and all of us, we're all here to help you. With an early diagnosis, early treatment, yes, we have patients that have made it and made it well. So let's not be scared. Let us be prudent. Let us be fast. Let us be decisive. That's my message.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Shushin. Dr. Afrin wrote here, the only way out of this pandemic is to get yourself vaccinated. Moreover, early diagnosis and reporting at the earliest can bring down morbidity and mortality. That's the parting message from Dr. Afrin. So from my bit is that we have kindly, I think we have dived into the mucor story quite a bit, and now we are far more aware of what is to be done and what not to be done. And yes, everybody talked about going back to basics and then early detection. And so I don't like to do webinars and not to have any action item. So I definitely would be asking all the panelists to give the tips, the one-liner to say what we should be educating the patient who are getting discharged after COVID. What is the set of advice that we can tell them how to watch out for, what need to be kept in mind? Maybe it is education, which is very different from 2020. I'm sure that nobody was educating the patient last year how to watch out for mucor, but this year it is very evident. So if you can just message me in the WhatsApp, I will create a document, and Dr. Gaurav and me, we will try to see how we can disseminate it to more nurses so that they can start partnering in educating patients, so that we can at least do our bit of preventing mucor from becoming rampant. You know, there's so much of fear in everyone, And we said the mortality, though it is higher than COVID, so now people are forgetting COVID, they're worried about, and moreover, it is very visual, right? When something happens, it is all visual. So it is literally a very big fear factor, you know, that is what it is. So thank you so much. If I say thank you is not good enough, but I feel very, very humbled that all of you said yes to my request and you have been here. This is 9:27. Can you imagine 2.5 hours? Dr. Afreen was telling, I thought I was supposed to speak a lot and 2 hours, what am I going to speak? Imagine Dr. Afreen now 2.5 hours, and if we sit here, we will be still answering questions because there are 171 people still sitting in this room. That shows the interest that they have to learn about Mucor. And that is, you know, the thank you so much, my audience, because that always raises my hope that nurses are interested. Somebody asked a question, will children get Mucor? I think Dr. Shushin already answered that question. The youngest was 23 and the oldest was 90. But I'm very sure even Dr. Shushin will not guarantee children will not get it, right? Yes, Dr. Shushin has an answer. Yes, Dr. Shushin.
We had recently, there were two patients reported in the government hospital in Bangalore. Both ages 12 and 14.
Oh,
both were juvenile diabetics. The parents of both of them had contracted COVID and they had serious illness. This Mucor developed in the background of a type 1 diabetes in both of the kids. So there are only two cases reported. And below 12 and 14, no.
I think, Dr. Shushin, don't you think there is a need for all these media people to be talking about this? The type, rather than, you know, bringing all the horrible stories, you know, they should talk about how to prevent type 1. Again, you told, you know, young children, type 1 diabetes, it's just a setting, just waiting for the Mucor to come. They should be aware, you know, that we are at risk of this, you know.
And come for the fact we suspended all media interactions about 2 weeks back because they were only fear mongering, you know. They were not coming out. See, we didn't have medications. We were trying to reassure them that we'll operate and then we'll give posaconazole or something. We'll try to save. But these people were, you know, were fear mongering. Then we decided that this is not the right time to talk to them. Then we stopped all the media interactions in the hospital. So they have a, you know, a problem to every solution, not the other way around.
I think they should get the doctors to talk to public to say, ki bhai, this is what you should do if you don't want to get Mucor, rather than, you know, talking about, you know, black fungus and yellow fungus and white fungus and people getting confused that if it is pink, then it is not Mucor, then it is something else. Then if you get these three colors, then it is fungus. If it's pink, then it's not, you know, fungus. But I think... I had a wonderful panelist, I should say. Thank you so much. I'm very happy.
One last thing.
Yes.
In my webinar with Dr. Anita, fungus is not bad. All the alcohol in this world which you get fungus only. So do not stigmatize fungus.
Yeah, please be very democratic.
I know. Yes. Tomorrow onwards, when I look at the bread and if there is a mold, I will say, oh my God, Mucor, go. You're going to have a morbid fear of mold. And I'm not going to tell my son anything of this because then he will start throwing all my plants also. The money plants are in water and you can see this, you know, black thing that happened. Usually you don't wash them away. Then he'll say, oh, that is now fungus, you know, throw it, you know. But I think we are ending on a very smiling note. Let's be very hopeful and let's do our best and let's not panic. And after work, we will not close the WhatsApp till I get advice from all of you to put a document together so we can disseminate. And, you know, it's like general education to COVID discharge patients, you know, what needs to be taken care at home. That's going to be an action item of this webinar. And thank you so much, Dr. Anita, Dr. Gaurav, Dr. Shushin, Bona, and Dr. Afreen. I'm really so sorry. I don't know. I am not able to hear your voice. You need to get your system phone checked. I didn't do anything from my side. I'm so sorry. So thank you, all of you, 159 people, and we are signing off.
Thank you
very much, and take care. And stay safe And last but not the least, please get vaccinated. And if your dear ones are not vaccinated, get them vaccinated also. Thank you very much and good night, all of you.
Thank you.
Take Bye. Care.
Thank you, Tankam. Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Thank you, ma'am. Good night.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Good night. Good night.
Thank you, ma'am.